Hello. On behalf of Reykjavik International Film Festival, I bid you all welcome. And we are, our honorary guest, Margareta von Trotta, is here. She, of course, was a well-known actress before she decided to go behind the camera and has written and directed a lot of award-winning films. But I really want to start at the beginning, yes. Because I actually think it has, it goes into your film, the way you are brought into the world. Mm-hmm. Your mother is born in Moscow and your father in Germany, but I understand that you actually, you had no state in the beginning, you were stateless.
No, that's true. No, because my mother was born in Moscow, but still during the Tsaristic times, and she was noble, of a noble house, or how do you say it? So, and she was not married. So I have the name of my mother. Von Trotta is a noble name. Von Trotta, genannt Treiden even. So we came, this family came of the Baltic lands, and they came first from Germany, and then with the Crusaders, they came to the east, to Riga and to the Balticum, and they conquered all these terrible German, they always conquered something. So then in these old times, they conquered the Baltic lands, and my family was mainly of German roots, but since before in 1800 and so, it was still all these lands and all these countries were part of the Tsaristic Reich. And my grandfather went to Moscow and he had an office and so in Moscow, and so his children were born in Moscow, being from a German roots but having the Russian nationality. After the revolution, they all lost the Russian nationality because from the Tsaristic Reich to the communist government, they all, that's like Hannah Arendt and the Jewish people who left 33 Germany, they lost their German nationality now, and they were then stateless. And to give them a sort of documentaries to show, because without a paper, without a passport, you are really helpless. There was a Norwegian diplomat, Nansen, who invented a passport for them, for these people losing their nationality, their Russian nationality. I have to sit a little bit, so otherwise I'm always with the back to you. That's not good. So, and so almost they had, this was a passport for strangers, but stateless for strangers, but they had a paper. And my mother never married, and so she was still, when I was born, she was still stateless, and so I become stateless naturally, even if I was born in Berlin. And that was some, it was when you are always asked in your childhood, what's your nationality, where you're coming from, and then you say always stateless, it means like homeless, like you have no country. So you are everywhere a stranger. You have the feeling to be everywhere a stranger. And it's on one hand, it's a unhappy feeling because you want to belong to some place or to some. On the other hand, it gave me this, I became a nomad. I'm going everywhere. I live in France. I can stay in Italy. I'm often in New York. So I have this feeling to be everywhere and to belong everywhere also. Now it's a belonging to all these places.
Yeah, and it's interesting because in some of your films, some of your better well-known films, you are actually touching up on a very dark part of the German history. Do you think it helped you not being kind of considered German? Because you're born before the war ends, actually.
Yes.
So you're in the midst of it all, but you've been able to research this history and get close to it in my opinion, in a very somber and bold way. Do you think it helped you to look at this part of the history?
I often ask myself if that's the reason. My mother was not interested in politics, I couldn't see it. Perhaps she was so upset about to leave Russia. She liked Russia very, very much, and so she felt always in Germany a little bit unhappy, and she thought Germans are very mean and say they are not generous enough like the Russians, they are generous and all this. And so I didn't get a real love for Germany on one hand with her speaking, but on the other hand I'm born in Berlin, so I'm part of the country, you know. And since we never heard after the war, mainly in the 50s, when we went to school, and we could have understood something, we never were told of our past. It was nor the teachers, the professors in school, nor our parent generation spoke about what happened during the war and during the Nazi time. And so and my film Lion at Sight, Leaden Times, it's after a sentence of a poem of Hölderlin, es ist als sei es in der blinden Zeit. And I took this blinded Zeit, for me the 50s were this time of Leaden. We felt that there was something in the past and we didn't know what. And so it was something very, very destroying in a certain way, not to know. And only in the 60s with the student revolution and then it started to come up what happened and then the young people were very, very furious with the further generation, and then it broke up and it was then we knew. But so I went in the early 60s, I went to Paris to study there or to learn the language, and I met some, because in the early 60s a new wave, new French wave of cinema was already born, and very exciting. But I came there for other reasons, just for the language. I was not interested so much in cinema, because in the 50s in Germany cinema was not very, very important. And so I met some students. They were very enthusiastic about the new wave of France, and they took me all the time in the cinemas and in the cinematheque. And so my university was more or less a cinematheque and cinemas, and not so much the university where I had to go to learn philosophy or you know. So. And then there I saw films of Bergman. At the first time, what Bergman, Hitchcock, the New Wave, New French Wave, all these films we never saw in Germany before. Or there were some of them, but we were not willing, perhaps, to go, or we were not aware that could be art, cinematographic art.
Yeah, it was more entertainment.
And then I was so touched by this sort of filmmaking that I thought that would be my dream to do that once in my life. But I didn't even dare to say it loudly, because to think that a woman could do a film and to be a director in these times, it was just unthinkable, and you would have get only laughter if you would have said it loud. So I took it here. It stayed in my in my heart, like in the Bible, Maria put everything in her heart, and so when I went back to Germany, I tried to get dramatic lessons. Okay. And dramatic school, and then I made some theater, but not very important, in the moment the new German wave started, that was in 65 and afterward, and then came Volker Schlöndorff and Alexander Kluge and others, Reitz, Edgar Reitz, perhaps you saw his Heimat films lately. So and then I tried to get into this clan, no, or this group, but I couldn't say I come with you because I want to learn to be a director. So I got in as an actress, and so slowly, slowly, I learned by looking at them how they did it, and being always very interested from the beginning to the end. I didn't just act. I always asked them why you do that like this, why the lightning is like this. So. Because I had no money to go to a film school. That was, I was a very pure student. So I had to learn it in this way.
And so you did. But you start co-directing with...
Yes, Schlöndorff. With Volker Schlöndorff, yeah. Yeah, he was my husband from 71 on. And so I worked with him together on all the films he did then, sometimes like a co-author, sometimes like an assistant, for my most important thing was that I was staying from the beginning, from the first word, no, on a paper until the very last cutting moment, and so
you went through the whole process.
Yeah, the whole no, because normally, as an actress, you are not staying all the time. But there, I insisted, and I was even more in the cutting room than he was.
Okay.
So
did you let him in on your secret that you wanted to be a director, or did you? Keep
no,
him
no.
In
then he knew. Then he knew. But he hoped that it would never happen.
But it did happen.
He lost a good assistant then, and I always gave him all my ideas. I put him into, and then I took them for myself. So that was not so well seen. But he helped me nevertheless to do the first film, and even if he didn't say to me that he went behind my back to the producers or to the television station where I wanted to get money from and said, if she is not able to do the film or to finish the film, I will do it, I will help her. So, so that they could be sure that they get a product they could show then on television. But and he tried even to come. The first day he let me alone, but the second he came and was staying all the time, and the people with whom I worked then, the cameraman and the sound man and so, they all have worked before already with him. So when I put the rails there and he came and said, "No, no, not there, here." So these poor people didn't know what to do because they didn't know me. They didn't know if I really am able, and he knew him. They knew him, so they were in between, and so we lost a lot of time in the evening. We did overtime, and what we didn't do the first day, and then the producer came to him and said, "You can't stand there every day. That's not it's not possible." And you can't come anymore, no? So he didn't come, and then in the end, no, he was also very humorous, and then in the end he said, I was waiting every day in front of the telephone that she calls me and say, come, I don't know how to do it. And it never happened, so... Then he knew he was lost, and I was on my way,
yes.
And I was not to stop anymore.
That's good. So you told him, showed him.
Yeah.
And that's your first solo film in 75.
No, that was, 75 we did the film together.
Okay,
the Lost Honor of Katharina Blum. There we did with the direction together. We wrote the script together, we did the directing together, and then I thought, now it's really the time that I make the jump to be on my own.
And that's Sisters?
No, that was Christa Klages, the second awakening of Christa Klages,
And I'm so curious, because the subjects of your films tend to be very strong women, not in all your films, and you've done a lot of TV as well, but again, your more known films, they have very strong females that are based on true stories, like true characters.
Not always. And I would not say it's always strong women, because they are protagonists, so they feel, they seem stronger than perhaps in other films where they are not just only, you know, beside. But for me it's very important to, even if a woman seems to be strong or is strong, they always have also their weaknesses. And you can't portray a person without also this other side, or the, let's say, the dark side of her own. So that is, then it becomes contradictory, and then it becomes interesting for me.
Yes.
So, and also, yeah, every, even Hannah Arendt, if you think she was a philosopher, she was a very, very intelligent, very strong woman. And even she had moments of unhappiness and of deep depression. And so it's, I think that is human also, and you have to show it.
Absolutely. But you do a lot of research on those characters and the life they're living,
depends,
and the political situation they're brought up with, etc.
Yeah, that is absolutely right. But I think you, outside of Germany, you don't see all my films. I have the rhythm is in somehow. How can I explain it? In one film, I'm looking outside. I'm looking to the world. I'm living in the world, I'm living in Germany, I'm living in a certain moment of history, and I'm living with open eyes. And so there's coming in what I see and what I feel in this very moment when I'm doing the film. It comes in, and then it comes also into the film. And then are other films where I'm just looking inside and looking what is there and what would I like to express. And that is a sort of coming and going. And one film is like this, the other film is looking, and then it's, and so it's a sort of rhythm. But since my films where I'm looking outside and where I'm speaking about German history and about, they are more known outside of Germany, so I'm always seen as the one who is only doing political films and only doing very strong women, and you know, it's a little bit disturbing for me, because I think it's a little bit minimizing, no? But what can I do? I'm happy that almost the other films are seen. Could be that no of my films will be seen outside of Germany, so it's okay.
But how do you approach the films you are making? I know you do a lot of research, but because, well, the films I've seen, which are the ones of your better known films, they're extremely human, and I'm so curious how you, the characters of your films, they are very human, and like you say, they're multiple, they have their strong side and their weak sides, and there's this constant fight. How do you think of your characters? How do you write them down? Again, you research on certain things, and then you have to pull the characters out.
That is true, and it's also very different from film to film. It always depends of the theme and also of the person I'm describing. And if I know her, for instance, personally, like in my first film is about a bank robbery done by a kindergarten, a woman who has an alternative kindergarten, and this kindergarten is lacking of money. And so and there are children from all over the world there, and they are from poor parents, so they can't pay. So she's very, very engaged in this kindergarten, and then one day, and she's a leftist in this time of alternative and not obedient what do you say, having obedience, no, to be in this kindergarten, but they are very free and tolerant and open-minded and not like order and obedience like the normal education in this time in Germany. So, and she does then with two other guys a bank robbery just to get money for this kindergarten. And then they are immediately, the other two are immediately taken and she has to hide and so she goes from hiding to hiding. And the main character, so this lady, bank robber lady, I knew her. She was in a way famous in this time in Germany because she was very attacked by the right press and as a criminal and I was curious, why did she do it? She didn't do it for herself. She did, no, but like normally bank robbers are doing to get money for themselves and that she didn't do that. And then I went to her to visit her in prison and she was such a wonderful woman and so really with such a big heart and so engaged but wonderful. And I couldn't understand that the press and outside she was so hated, no? Yeah. So I wanted to for this also to do a film to go to show that there are people who are not being judged so easily from outside, no? So I made a research about her, visiting her, but also what she did she before, and I asked her colleagues in the kindergarten and so to know a little bit what character she is. But then all the other story where she's going and she meets somebody of Riga and then she meets an old friend who's a hairdresser and she gives her shelter. And so all this voyage, all the she has to do until the end, in the end she gives up and she is taken, but the bank employee, which observed her during the bank robbery, she looked her and she was masked, but she could nevertheless she could remember her face, and she, from her side, she was so curious and interested that she made also all the steps. To know why she did it. She went to the mother, she went to the kindergarten, she went, and always with a very serious face, and you had the feeling she hates her, and because she was a very severe employee, you know, very punctual every morning, and then she sees that you can have a total other life, and you can be much more free than she is. Now, and in the end, the last scene is that the bank lady, the kindergarten lady, she is confronted with this bank employee, and she's asked, "Was it this woman?" And you know, you think now she says yes, and then she says no.
Exactly.
And that was a wonderful ending.
Is that a sisterhood?
Yeah.
It's a sisterhood.
No, that's not true. That is my invention. No. That's my invention.
But
I think this poor employee, she never had the freedom of deciding herself about something. No, and there was a moment that she could see that this woman was not a criminal.
But the real bank robber,
yeah.
she
went out of the then after two or three years she came out of, but she had not murdered nobody. It was not, just took the money, so there was no murder in. And then I took her as a script girl. And yes, for several films she was script girl with me. No, because she was so interested, and then she even became a film director. She did two or three films. Yeah, that was my sort of helping her.
It's a lovely story. And she appears in the film, right?
Yes. She is a kindergartner in the film.
Exactly.
She's the one.
It's a lovely story.
Yeah.
But anyway.
No, and that was so, that is there I really get in touch with her. I knew her personally. I went around to know more about her, but then the whole story, I invented the whole, her voyage through Germany, and it was a sort of, for me, a voyage through Germany of that time, yeah. Of this very time. No, and yeah, and then the second film, that was absolutely, I knew nothing. Yeah. Sisters or Balance of Happiness. There I was sitting in front of a white page, and I didn't know, and I started, and then it came out a story of two sisters.
Of two sisters?
Yes.
Very two different sisters, very different.
Yes. You know the film? You saw it? No.
I've
Sisters or Balance of Happiness.
It,
yeah.
I've never seen
yeah.
it.
So no, but that was really a total invention, and it's somebody. Oh, I always also have my not. Go on, speak. We can have a little moment. You can speak, and then we go on. No.
But Marianne and Juliana.
Yeah.
You knew the sisters that story is based on.
Yes, that's the third film, and that's again, as I said, looking outside, looking inside. That is the third film, looking outside. But even looking outside, you always have to find some connection, inner connection with the person you are portraying. It's not only looking like for a documentary, you can just film and looking and showing what's there. But for my films, I have really to introduce the person, also the bank lady, inside of me to then describe her. I'm never objective, I'm never only outside of the story. I have always to go deeply in.
Yeah.
And for the third film, Lie on the Side, which was shown yesterday, I think,
yes.
No? Yeah, there I was, I did know only one of the sisters, and only in the moment of the funeral of the so-called terrorists in Germany in 77. The Baader-Meinhof group, when you remember perhaps the politics of these years, and the three of Gudrun Enslin and two others were buried in Stuttgart. And I went to the funeral, and at the funeral was also the sister of Gudrun Enslin, of one of these, the only woman in the moment who was buried there. And Volker Schlöndorff and Kluge, they came there to make a documentary. Germany in Autumn was the film. It was a collective film then about the time, because there was this terrible hysteria against terrorists in this time, and everybody was supposed to be a sympathizant. Sympathizer, how do you say it in English?
Sympathizer.
And or even the terrorists. So it was really a very difficult time in Germany. And so they did this film, Germany in Autumn, and I went there and I met so the sister, and she was totally broken, and she was very, very deeply moved, and so she took me and for two days I was together with her, and she told me everything about herself, about her sisters, about her relationship with her sister, about her family, about her political opinions, and so, and her fight with her sister, because she was one. She was also a leftist, let's say, but she was willing to transform the German society slowly by going slowly, no, but step by step. And her sister Gudrun Enslin, she was the one who was too impatient for that, and she went then with a terroristic group, and. And so she told me everything, and I was just there taking her, like, because I felt that she was so in need to speak with somebody. And only after half a year or 6 months, I thought, my God, that would be a good theme. And I could show the whole story of Germany with these two sisters. And starting up in the war, during the wartime, and then in the 50s, and then in the 60s when the student rebellion came and we started to understand something, and then this division between the two sisters. And in the first place, the film was called for me in the stadium of the scriptwriting, The Change, because in their childhood or in their youth, the rebellious sister was the older one, which were afterwards the one who wanted to go step by step, and the one who was always nice with the teachers and nice with her father and very like this, no, very she became then the so-called terrorist. So that was really the change, or the, how do you think, if you are changing clothes also. And in the film, in one moment they are changing the sweater in prison. So but then I thought it's more you have to describe a whole time, a whole period, a whole epoch, and that was so I changed the title. Even if it's a little bit disturbing, because in the title of the film in English or in the English speaking countries, it's so different. In England, it was called The German Sisters. In America, Marion and Julian, and in Australia, The Leaden Times. So nobody knows what's the right title. And one time, my Barbara Sukowa, who is one of my main actresses in all my films, that was the first film we did together, and she plays the so-called terrorist girl therein, and she wanted to show to a Hollywood producer the film, but she knew only the title in English, The German Sisters. And so she did I'm in German System, and they made come the German sisters, the Sisters of Bells of Happiness, because in America it was Marion and Julian. So they saw up my skill, and they saw Archie did a film, Sisters of Balance of Happiness. That must be this film. And they looked at it, and Barbara is not in it. So that's these confusions. That was for her, it was not so nice.
But this is an interesting subject. Yeah. Does the title change often from the idea until you finish the film? Like the whole.
Sometimes. I'm not so fond of the title, and I always think I have to change this during already I'm shooting, but then in the end I can't do it anymore, because I get so used to the title that I can't stop my mind to think it in this way. But with Blinded Sight, with the title of that was before I was shooting. Before I'm shooting, I still can change the title, but not when I'm shooting. Then it becomes like a jacket or a clothes or something. So it's even with my very last film, which is A Misplaced World in German, it's Die Abhandene Welt. Everybody told me you have to change the title. It's disturbing. You don't know what it means, and so. And it's very poetic, but it's not very griffish, no, it's not very effective perhaps, but I couldn't. So it's the title of the film, and now people are not going in because the title is... No, sometimes it hurts the film, but... No, so we can go on with every film. For every film, it's another story, how it starts and how you get in, and how perhaps I can speak about the films with the big names of Rosa Luxemburg. I did a film of Rosa Luxemburg. You all know who she is. I did a film about Hildegard von Bingen. That was an abbess in the medieval ages in Germany. Very now well known for a whole time, totally forgotten. But now with the movement, the feminist movement, she came up again. And Hannah Arendt. These three are my, let's say, my big names, woman names. Yeah. And therefore I'm always identified with strong women.
Not a bad thing to be identified with.
Okay, though, I accept. No, but to tell you then, that is interesting for you perhaps. I'm always starting with letters. If these women or these persons wrote letters, I'm starting with letters because when I can't have still testimonies from real person, Rosa Luxemburg, I had only two, which I still met. It was an old anarchist and a pupil of her when she was teaching in a political school. But they both were 90 and 100, so they had such a long life after they met Rosa Luxemburg. And I wanted only to know this piece of Rosa Luxemburg, no? And they only wanted to tell me everything. It was interesting. They had an interesting life, but it was a little bit, I always had to say, and Rosa Luxemburg, which was, it's like in Tartuffe, no, you know, Molière, the piece of Molière, where the male terrible father isn't interested in in his wife, nor in his daughter, nor only in Tartuffe, no, and when there's coming somebody who says, da-da-da-da-da, and Tartuffe, qu'est-ce qu'il fait Tartuffe? Tartuffe, il est là, et puis il raconte, et puis il tells everything bad of this Tartuffe, but the father wants only to know, so it was a little bit with me, no? Rosa Luxemburg? So, okay, so she wrote, Rosa Luxemburg wrote 2,500 letters. Oh, she wrote more. But that was the letters left. And I read them all. I had still to go to the Marxist-Leninist Institute in East Berlin in this time. It was a long time before the wall came down. And I had really to cross Friedrichstrasse to know, and always with these terrible policemen all in these boxes which are looking at you like, and never a smile. I always tried to make them smile. It was nothing to, so I had to cross the border. I went by feet until the institute was half an hour to go there, and there I could look in the things they had also other interesting things about, but for me the letters were the most important. And so I read them five times and thinking, what is then after this, without taking notes, and I thought, what might be then, what I will be remember after these five, that will be the thing I'm interested in, her. And so that was my first step. And then, sure, I read everything she wrote and all her speeches and her books. And I wrote also, Remembering Her by her best friend and so on. But first I have, and that I did with Hildegard von Bingen also. She had made a big correspondence with popes and with other abbesses and with and also Hannah Arendt. Hannah Arendt, there's a whole bibliothèque with volumes of letters to so many people. And because also I think that you are always writing or being another person, depending which whom you are corresponding. When I'm writing to you, I write in another way than I write to a man, or write to a teacher, or write to a boy, or and so it becomes like a kaleidoscope of a person for me, and that is this is important to get into the character, and to like. And to like the person I will portray. I have to love and to like my persons, otherwise I couldn't do.
So you kind of carve through the letters to learn them to love them.
Yes. That's and then I can then I can start.
But I was curious because when you do Hildegard, it's you are also the set design or the art. You are credited as art director on that, isn't it?
Oh no!
Oh, it's wrong then.
No, I was like, no. In the catalog here, preparing my coming is also that I'm doing documentary films. I never did a documentary film.
Oh, okay.
So I'm only fiction.
But you did do a lot of TV.
Yes,
and
both.
Why was
yeah.
that? Why did you turn to TV?
No, because I had a project about the what was it? Yeah, the German war. It was in 1993. I wrote together with Peter Schneider, a well-known writer, German writer, a script about the two Germanys from the beginning of the war in 61 until 89. We did the film. And after this, I had another project, Rosenstraße, which you see this evening, and I couldn't get the money. And I had a producer, but he always said, we will do it in autumn, and then in autumn he said in spring, and in spring he said in autumn, and so it went on. And then I got out of money. And my friend of the Cologne television, because before I always did my films together with the money of television, but not only television, they co-produced, but it was always for cinema. And I didn't tell him, but he felt it, that I was really on the edge of losing, no? And then he went to this television station and said to another, the director of the television film station there, I think we have to offer her something to do for us. Because I always said, I never will do television. Television for me is a little bit too arrogant, so I had to pay for it, and then they proposed me a script, which I changed a little bit, and they wanted also that I change it, and then I saw that it's not so bad to do television. It was okay, and it was a challenge, because you have much less time to do a good film, but you try to do a good film nevertheless. For me, it's not a difference to make television as a filmmaker. And I try to get a good story, to make it really as a film, as if it's done for the cinemas, only that you have less money and less time. And so it's a good exercise. And after the film, they immediately proposed me other films, and so I went on a little bit for a certain time with television. And then came the time that, because in the 90s, nevertheless of our important story of after the wall came down, then all the problems with the East and the West and coming together and not liking each other, and it was really a problematic time, but people wanted to see only comedies. So it was this theme I had then with Rosenstraße. It was not yet, and everybody said, "Oh, that is a Nazi time. Who wants still to know something about this time? And it's forgotten. And let it be. And put it in the toilet or what?" So and all of a sudden, my friend, always the one of television, but he also always helped me to get money for the, and he said, we'll try again. Now, I think the time is over that people want to say or see only, you know, these silly things. And in fact, we got money then for the film, for Rosenstraße, and I did it. And from then on, I stayed with, mainly with cinema films, but from time to time, when I'm have a good offer from television, I do it. So it became both.
Yeah, well, but what do you feel is the biggest? Do you feel there's a big difference in how you work with feature films and then television films?
It's just the idea that a film is shown on a big screen and in cinemas and going around the world, and always people are, because that was when I got this idea or this desire to make films my own with Bergman, and as I told you, in Paris, that was on a big screen, that was in the dark, and it was marvelous, and on the little screen, even if you have much more public in the same moment, there's so many more public you never can get in a cinema to see the film. But for me, it's that the difference.
Yeah. But having heard so much, waiting to make Rosenstrasse, and you hear all the time people are not interested in this anymore, etc. Did it surprise you? Because it did get a very great public.
Yes, it was a very successful
yeah.
film then. So it's not always that people know what to do. Sometimes, but perhaps it was good to wait so long that when I would have done it before, perhaps it would have not been this response. Maybe sure. Sometimes destiny helps you to sometimes. Be patient. I'm very patient.
But I
no.
think... But do you
not really, but sometimes.
Yeah, I don't consider patience a virtue. No.
So sometimes it's a virtue. Sometimes. If you can do other things in between, but you don't give up. Then when the time is there, and then you jump and you do it.
Yeah, but it's like with all the characters I know from your films, their virtues or talents can be positive things. They can also turn, in certain circumstances, they can turn to negative things. But I'm just curious, do you think, like, making films like Rosenstrasse and Hannah Arendt, those are still relevant films, right? Because the world is still, those things are still happening in the world. So it's still a very relevant subject, right?
Yes, but that you never know when you're doing a film. You never know if it will last. And if you, for instance, can blind at sight, yesterday there was a young director, a Canadian woman director, and she saw the film yesterday here in the cinema. And she was totally enthusiastic, and she liked it. And I said, but really, it still works. I did it in 81, and it's still there, it still works. And she said, yes, yes, it's still, sometimes films are aging, no? There are other films, I think they are, you can forget them, but some are lasting, and you never know before.
You never know
no,
before,
no.
But I just want to ask, do you think it could be because you handle the subject through the emotions of your characters? Because people's emotions don't change that much, do they? Even though times change.
Yeah, that is true.
Yeah. So
hate is still there, even too much in our time. Greed, there are some things they never change.
Yeah.
And you are upset for it that they don't change, but perhaps there's somebody of you. We want to ask them. Perhaps.
Yeah,
they,
but I just.
Oh
want
yes.
To ask
okay.
One
no, no.
More
it's
thing.
It's wonderful. It's wonderful with her. I think she's marvelous. Don't you think so? She's very. I like to answer her. It's not always the same when you are asked by people you are, and then you go. But with her, it's really fine. Really
nice. Thank you. But I want to be a bit selfish now because I work as a film editor, as you know.
I know, so and I you are good. You're also a good editor, you're a good Thank filmmaker, you. You're a good editor. She has some more qualities than I have. I have never edited my own films.
I like her. But what is the editing process to you and your films? Because I know you put so much in the writing of the script. So much research, and you work, and of course you work with beautiful actors, and I know you work very closely with them. I can't imagine seeing you with a monitor like half a mile from the actors, like sending.
Yes, but it's another moment of the filmmaking,
and
I have always, I think I have always had very good editors. So I like to give them the responsibility, take the material and now take it, because it's a new look, it's a new emotion, it's a new and I like that, and sure I'm there and I'm coming and going, but I'm not there and say you have to do that. I'm always interested and curious what is coming out of the material, and sometimes editors are really protecting and saving you also from errors. No, you know that better than me. So I'm very confident.
I really like the way the process in the editing, because you have all this material that everyone mm-hmm. has attributed to through the filming process, and then you like carving through it. And
no, before when there was still real film material, no 35 millimeter material, you went with your rushes already in the evening or the next evening. It had to be developed first, and then we went into a projection room or into a cinema, and you saw it, and then already you chose. The first choice is during the filming. There already you say copy this one and copy the first one, the third one, let's say the seventh shot. That is all already a certain limitation or elimination, and then you go to with these rushes. You go to the big screen, and then you say this one, and your editor is beside you, and they will say take this one, take this one, and that I always had woman editors. Then she does, but sometimes she's looking up the material again, and she said, "Look here, I think this moment is better in this shot. Can't we take it in?" And we do it because you have better eyes. Yeah, the editors have really, they are looking very, very, very.
But does it happen to you that you feel you have to change the structure of the story? Because I know you work non-linear. You've done very non-linear films.
Yeah, no, that was already in the script.
Yeah.
That was already in the script.
In the script. So yeah. You worked it.
Yeah.
So you keep the same structures.
More or less. Yeah. For instance, for Blinded Sight, no, for the film we are speaking about, I gave the script to the editor already before I shot it. Okay. And she said, look, these two scenes, put them together in one scene. Or this, yeah, she already gave me some, and I did it, and it was really well done. No, perhaps in the end, if I would haven't had her advice, and I would have shot two scenes, and then she could put them together, but it was not the same thing.
No.
But that was we are cutting out a lot. Then for by Blinded Sight, we cut out 20 minutes. I had 20 minutes more shot, and also in the screenplay and shot. Then it's in the film. I often go down in minutes when I feel that it's too much.
But I like to ask you because I heard you say that your next project is a comedy.
I try for once a time.
Yeah.
No, but what I yesterday, I don't think that you saw the film, perhaps, but that was my very last film, Misplaced World, and now in this evening is shown Rosenstraße. And I looked it up this morning in the catalog, and I said, "Oh my God, that's very. They are very close. They're both about family secrets. You get and in the film yesterday, the story starts in Germany, and then the sister goes to New York to try to get out the story of the secret story of the family. And in Rosenstraße, this, which is shown this evening, it starts in New York, and then the woman goes, or the daughter goes to Berlin to get to the story of her mother. And I never thought about that. That is absolutely familiar, only that the places are opposite.
Yeah, but this is what yeah, and that about is yesterday. It's your
yes,
insight, your
and
insight,
that is something
intuition.
Happening totally unconsciously.
Yeah.
And when I discovered it this morning. I said, "My God, you're always doing the same thing." yeah, sometimes you think you are boring because you have always the same ideas. But yeah.
Oh, I wish we could go on and on because because the Misplaced World is a very personal. There you become very personal. Mm-hmm. It's your personal based on your personal story. But Sisters, is that also kind of is that? I sometimes wonder, is that about you, Sisters?
The first one, not Blinded Sight,
the
Sisters
of
Balance
of Happiness.
No, that was really a total invention, but afterwards I understood that it has also something to do with me.
Yeah.
Sometimes you know it only afterwards. You think you are invented, like I did a film, Sheer Madness, with Hannah Schicola and Angela Winkler, and Angela Winkler is a painter, which is also always copying masterpieces of art, in black and white, and she says she's also dreaming in black and white, and it's a whole story about the two women, but I won't tell the whole story. Only that she copies in black and white, and I thought it's my total invention. And then after the film was done, late after that, it came in my mind when I was in Paris, and I went very, very often to the Louvre in this time, and there was an old lady sitting always in front of the big artist, and she copied in black and white. And I was standing beside her and looking at her, and it was I think it impressed me so much that I went into my background of my memory, but I didn't remember the moment I wrote it down. I didn't remember for nothing. So you have a lot sort of treasure, no? You have a sort of cellar where it is very dark, and you put in everything which comes in, and then sometimes it shows up, and even that you don't know that you have it here, that it comes from here, and that are the most beautiful moments for me when I feel that there is something, and I'm not forgetting everything, because now in my old days I forget all the names and so there's something which lasts, which is there. And
that's lovely. So should we take some questions from the audience?
If there is somebody who wants to know something, that would be nice of you. No.
Yes. Maybe we covered it all.
Here.
Hello. I was wondering, in the very beginning, you touched very briefly on you getting into film. And that it was hard for you as a woman to get into film in the 60s.
Which film you are speaking about?
Just in general, in film business, to become a director.
In the film business, speak a little bit louder.
Yes, I'm going to try.
Go into the, that everybody can understand you.
Yes. Okay. What I was going to ask is, in the very beginning of the talk, you touched upon getting into film business and how it was hard for you as a woman to get into film business in the 60s. And I am myself an aspiring filmmaker in Germany. And looking at the numbers right now, just the percentages, it's still harrowing to see how little films get made by women.
No, and there are a lot of films, but they get a lot less money.
Right, that's what I meant.
Point, yeah.
Yes. And I was wondering, A, if you have any advice for young female filmmakers, how to make it or how to not lose courage in the face of that? And B, what you think about quotas and that sort of thing?
I'm a member of this quota action.
Oh, really?
Yes. They asked me to be the grandmother of all this movement. I said, okay, I'm with you, but I don't go. And you have to do it. We did it in the late 70s in Germany. We were a group of four or six. Women filmmakers, we went around and said we want to have the half of the money and so on, and we did we fought a lot, and then okay, with the time it becomes tiring now, and even always to be the feminist, it's a little bit tiring, and now, And now there's these young women directors in Germany, and they became aware that it's still a miss portion, let's say, between men, female and male directors, and they created this pro quota. That is a movement to get. And to force and to also the people of television and also of the subsidies institutions to give the same money to women than to men. And there I'm in, but I'm not going around and, you know. But they when they need me, I'm there. Okay.
That's great.
Yes, so I think we should finish now. Unless there's...
There's still somebody? Yeah, there was there another one.
You,
no. Oh, no.
Oh, they're too young. We won't let you go. So. I have maybe a more of a film historical question, but when you were starting making movies and just this movement of the new German or young German cinema, how was it replacing those old men probably that were there, that were the system that you were kind of fighting against? I mean, did they help you or were they kind of in opposition? Because the books just tell of how you came and you conquered, but...
It was a movement much earlier than I stepped in. With Reitz and Kluge, and they are all already another generation than I'm. But and they did this manifesto of Oberhausen, no, where they said the Opa's Kino is taught, the cinema of the grandfathers is over. Now we are in the same position, and there the young, they say you have to go to. Not to bed, but to the grave. But and we don't like that. But in this time, they. But it was a sort of over. Also, it was a change in politics. It was a change in you know, the thinking. And it was really the time in the mid of the 60s to change. And then they came in, and it was the right moment. And it was mainly they were looked up in the festivals in the world, no? And with the Goethe Institute also we could go and show our films around the world, and it came the echo, the attention to our filmmaking came from outside, And then it came back to Germany. And then they oh, we have some directors here that they are good and they are well known now in the world. And then they helped. They started to help. Because in the beginning, when you got money from television, then television had the right for the first night. And you couldn't show your film then afterwards in the cinemas. And there was Volker Schlöndorff and Kluge and all these first directors. And they went to Bonn and they made lobby work in Bonn to get the right to have 2 years before you go in television, that you can get television money with others, with subsidies and so on, and have the right to show your films for 2 years first in the cinemas. And that was a turning point. Then really they started to become the new German filmmaker wave.
Yep.
It's okay?
Yeah.
Hi, I'm just wondering about the rewriting process. How long does it take usually? And there are so many opinions. What do you listen to all the people, or do you stick to your own heart? Or you know, it's just how do you do those things? The rewriting process.
She's asking about the script writing. There are so like you have so many opinionated people around you, like producers or. If they affect your work,
there's a lot of critics. When I write my first script and then I show it, and then they say, oh no, that is good and that is not good, and then I have to see what I can take from them when I think it's good, and they have better judgments, or I fight for it. So it's I can't take something I'm not convinced. And I even, for instance, for Hannah Arendt, that was not on the script level, but it was on the actors level, and all the producers and all the people giving me money, they said, no, you can't take Barbara Sukowa. She is not looking like Hannah Arendt, and you took her too often in your films, because that was already the sixth film we did together, and it's counterproducing. You can't take her. You have to choose another actress. And then I said, no, then I don't do the film. I need her, because I know that she's the most intelligent actress in Germany. And I needed somebody who I could look in her eyes and I could believe her that she's thinking, and not only make believe that she's thinking, but she thinks really. And that she does, and she is, for me, she is the best actress really we have. So when I said, no, I don't do the film, and then they went in and they said, okay, go, okay, no. And then they saw the film and they loved her. And they went to her knees, their knees in admiration. And then I said, my God, you are so stupid. Couldn't you see that before? Couldn't you know that before? No, and so you have to fight with this sort of stupidity sometimes.
Thank you. But the process, the writing process, does it take 2 years or 3 years?
It depends. It depends. Sometimes I'm writing in 2 months, and sometimes for Rosa Luxemburg, I needed two years. Because to read everything and to really go into the subject, into all the things you have to read to know what to know. And if you are doing your own script, coming up for on your own, of your own heart, of your own experience, so that is much quicker. You have not to have this. I have always so much respect for this woman, no, strong woman, no. And I'm so therefore I always fear that I'm not on the level of them, that I don't do them right, you know, I don't do them justice. That is my main fear then. And so it lasts longer.
And so you read 2,500 letters five times.
Five times. That you have to do that.
I think that
going over this to the east side of Berlin.
Yes. Yeah.
And then I was still a heavy smoker, and I couldn't smoke in the room where I could read the things, and there was a smoking room, and there was always somebody who had to follow me, and he said, "Oh, I also want to smoke." He was not a smoker, but he had to, because they couldn't let me alone. No? That was the East Germany. Yeah. It came to me then afterwards only that they always followed me. I couldn't do nothing on my own.
But you're very fearless, because you're traveling to Paris when you are stateless. So you had to have like visas to go.
Yeah. And sometimes once they put me out, they
being followed. And
No. I'm fearless.
So yes, I'm passionate.
But. In front of bombs. I wouldn't be fearless in Syria or in Iraq now. No. That is very, very different. I don't fear people or to confront people like that. But when they have a gun, I go down.
Yes.
To protect me. I'm not going there. So
because you're sensible.
Shoot me. No.
Yes. That's very sensible.
I think we got two questions left in the room. There's one over here and then one over there.
Yeah, my name is Guðbjörg Guðmundsdóttir, and I would like to ask you a silly question.
Two?
Silly question. I would like to ask you a silly question.
Oh, yes, please.
I would like to... I came a little bit late, so I don't know whether you have been talking about it before. I would like to ask you, what film directors have you been influenced or by through the years? Your favorite film director?
Oh, my favorite films are the films of Bergman. That was the first ones, and that there. But I have a long list of favorite films.
And your German filmmakers, what are your favorites?
They are all coming from Faust. From the 20s.
From the 20s. Okay, thank you.
Okay, I see that people want to go. There are so many already. They went up and...
Last question.
Yeah, I think it... To him. Yeah, I think it just came when I asked for the word.
Stand up so the other can hear you.
Well, basically, I just wanted to ask you about fear. Like, because you went through the German New Wave and being the only female.
No, I'm not the only. I'm the last of my generation.
Well, basically, I wanted to ask you about fear. Do you ever feel fear like you did Hannah Arendt? And it's really...
Yeah, I'm always fear. No, I'm topic. Always full of fear. But you have to go against. I can't live with fear. I wouldn't never do a film when I would go with my fear. I must go with my courage.
So you just accept that your job is that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, go.
Fine.
No, but before I started, last sentence, I was with Brecht. Brecht once said, even if you make shit, it's better than you make nothing. And so that was for me. I didn't know if I can do a film. That is always a risk. And I said, okay, I will try. And when I make shit, okay, then perhaps I don't get a second chance. But I want to have the opportunity. So do it. And then you see.
Thank you. Very good answer. Thank you.
We will make this the last words of this talk. Thank you so much for coming. It's
Thank
always
you.
A pleasure.
You are so wonderful. She's so wonderful.
Thank you.